the Maneater panel here at PAX. Yay! So, hopefully everyone's had a great PAX so far. First day. It's exciting. Everything's broken. All right, so for those who may not know why they're here, we're going to start off with a handy-dandy little trailer.
Closer with that camera, we two gonna toss him.
So Maneater, at its core, is an open-world action RPG where you, the player, are a shark. And let's show you how the game actually looks. You guys are the first non-press to see the game in action.
You want to do your setup with Chris Barnett?
All right, so Maneater is told through the lens of a reality TV show, Shark Hunters versus Maneaters. The host of the show is voiced by none other than Chris Parnell. You might know him from 30 Rock, Archer, Saturday Night Live. He's kind of a funny guy. And he's following along, and he's telling us what's happening around our shark and acting sort of like the voice of our shark. So let's drop right on in.
The bull shark is one of the ocean's most feared predators, an insatiable beast intent on devouring everything in sight.
So Trent here has dived into Dead Horse Lake, and he's
groupers can live up to 50 years, but not if this shark has anything to say about it.
So as you can probably see, our shark is starting to char down, picking up some of those nutrients. We've got four nutrients in the game: proteins, fats, minerals, and our rare mutagen X, which perhaps will allow our shark to grow beyond.
Catfish are monogamous, meaning someone, special someone, won't be coming home tonight.
So, Trent's only found one type of resource, so we're gonna keep looking around, and we found a bridge that can't get under, but that's not a problem for our shark. He is nimble, he is quick, he can leap from the surface and the knife in the kitchen, or she can dive deep, pick up speed, and go for Olympic gold.
A breaching shark is a beautiful and terrifying sight.
So, if you listen in carefully, you'll probably hear a little bit of a ping in the background. That's the game's way of letting us know there's probably some secrets to discover here.
I would like to assure the Antolini crime family that this footage will in no way be used in the final edit of our program.
Like our first landmark here, the snitch parking lot. And as Trent looks around, it looks like somebody's got a bit of a snitch problem, but they're working on it. They'll get there. So that's probably not our secret though, so let's keep looking.
This shark isn't quite ready to tackle the full-grown reptile.
So, Rosie there is one of our apex predators. You are not the only predator in these waters. And in fact, there are seven, what we call kings of the seas, that perhaps don't like you in their territory.
No one can tell what may be found in a shark's stomach. It's truly the ocean's garbage can.
And Trent has found a nutrient cache, giving him a major injection of all those tasty, tasty nutrients. With our secret found, let's head back into the wider lake and and see if we can't find something that can be a bit closer to the water. Now, as you might have noticed, when we dropped into the demo, it is currently nighttime outside. And that actually plays a very important role in how the game works. It has a full day-night cycle, and the activities of the other aquatic animals in the ocean and who's out and what they're doing will change, as well as the activities of the humans and what they're doing. At night, they're probably pulled back from the shore. During the day, fun time. Friend likes to play with his food.
Sharks help balance food webs by keeping human populations healthy and in proper proportion to their ecosystem.
Friend's being an environment. Now, you know, the thing about humans is they're pack creatures. When there's one, there's probably a few more. So, mass plays a very important part of how combat plays out in Maneater. The mass of your shark versus what you are trying to engage with, be it humans, other sea life, or even boats. Trent is continuing to play with his food, showing off what we like to call as the whip shot. Anything you put in your mouth as a shark, you can use as a projectile.
Studies show that while sharks do enjoy deep house and trance, their one true love is hardcore German techno.
So, friends never want to not join in on a party. And as you saw, our shark can actually leave the water for a bit of time. But she must quickly return. Unless there are some evolutionary choices you may take along the way to enhance your time outside the water. Now, as Prince continuing to terrorize our local population here, that is not going to be without consequence. Bounty hunters are going to be called in to help protect the local citizenry. So, with a couple more. Wonderful bites.
A new day dawns. Bayou Willie was actually born on a river, not a bayou.
So, Trent could use this time to dive into the waters and slip away while they search his last known location. Or, he could choose to take the fight back to our bounty hunter. And I think he's gonna do that.
Sharks typically have four motives: hunger, mistaken identity, aggression, and self-defense. But what if there's a fifth motive, such as a life insurance scheme?
Now, these bounty hunters are going to come out in waves until you are either killed, driven away from these waters, or defeat them all. If you manage to defeat all the bounty hunters in a certain area of water, you will lay claim to them, where the humans will recede from that area for a time until you have moved on. And it will give your shark some exclusive upgrades to choose from for their next evolution.
Sharks are capable of atrocities so appalling, the mind recoils from the thought.
So Trent will pull up the map. So you can see, we dropped into Dead Horse Lake. We found our landmark objective over there on the left, but there's a lot more to see here, though sadly not for today's demo. We have seven major regions, all the way down to the deep ocean of the Gulf Coast. And each of those regions looks different, feels different, has different species of wildlife in them. So, we're going to show you one more bit of gameplay in the form of a video, because it's not available in the build I have today. But it'll give you a look at our little baby shark, as well as two other areas. Thank you. And I just realized, because I am such a horrible person, I forgot to introduce ourselves. So, I'm Jared Creasy. I'm the community manager here at Tripwire Interactive.
I'm Trent Mendoza. I'm the marketing team here at Tripwire.
I'm Brian Wanya. I'm the lead character artist at Tripwire Interactive.
And that's important, because Brian, you're the star of the next part of our show. You're going to tell us everything about what goes into making video game sharks, aren't you?
I will, but I would definitely have to preface that it's the art team is definitely the show of this. This is a lot of different departments, not just character art. From character art in general is obviously we're building the characters that are going into the game, but we have to work very closely with the rigging, animation department, and design and concept as well. So it takes a lot just to put any character into a game, and we have come to realize there was just as many new challenges with putting sharks, people, scuba divers. You saw the amount of variety of things we have to make. It's funny, though, for a character art team, we've made more fish, so it's almost like a fish team, if you will. But yeah, I want to take a little bit and talk to you about the three things we talk about most at work when developing the game in general is eat, grow, evolve. You're constantly doing one, if not more, of those things as you're in the game. So the first thing I would like to show you is kind of the menu, if you will, for the player shark. And we have a huge variety. You guys saw everything from sea turtles and seals and just a ton of stuff. So we start really small, and this is, I believe this is the North Atlantic spade fish. By the way, I'm not by any means an outdoorsman at all. When we first started the project, I tried to take, I have a 7-year-old daughter, and I took her fishing. And we literally had to like go to like Walmart beforehand to get the stuff to go fishing, so that shows you how prepared I was. We went there with 2 fishing poles, nets, and all that, and I think we only left with one, not only no fish, but one fishing pole. So we actually left stuff there. So we did much better digitally than we did in real life. So yeah, this is our Atlantic spade, and we'll start small and we'll show you some of the other fish that we kind of have. Now, this is our grouper. One thing, we're a very small character team. We have essentially 3 artists. We do work with some outsourcing studios to help supplement some stuff as well. But we needed to find a way to create a lot of variety in the world. And the cool thing about certain particular species of fish, on our left you have what would be like our standard grouper, which we'll see kind of in more inland areas. And then on the top right, you have your coral grouper, which we can essentially use that same asset, but retexture it in some slight model adjustments to get an entire new fish out of it. This really helps because the character art department, we can't just start like cranking out fish because we have to make sure that rigging and animation has time. So we're able to kind of share rigs and share animations with some of these species, but yet still have a very developed world and not you just eating like a few fish. So another example of this, we have our sailfish. Actually, I believe this is our blue marlin. And then in the next one is our sailfish. So this was another example of the character team. We have an artist named Samantha, and she did a fantastic job of very quickly being able to take this fish compared to the next fish. So there's a lot of similarities, but the big thing for us was the silhouette was different. It's got a slightly different texture, and then we can also globally scale them in-game. So they share the same rig, they share the same animation, so it's not a huge impact for other departments, but yet the player will hopefully get some sense of variety. Because all the research that we did before the game, it's really shocking how many different things are under the water. And all the things that you can see, but how can we asset-wise and time-wise build essentially a whole new world under the water?
Because there's a whole world above water, too.
That's true, and that leads us to, and it's funny, the character art team, people in the game, which how many of you would like to work in games or do character art? Like, I teach a lot as well, and I always tell students to like learn anatomy and in this sense, we were all really focusing on our animal anatomy, and we then, you know, we have pretty strong human anatomy skills. We stylize them a little bit so you didn't feel like an awful murderer the whole time you were eating people. So they're a little more playful. But yeah, people in our game essentially act as a resource. We do have some story characters that help fill out the story, but these are an example of kind of some of the technical limitations and the way we kind of worked through this. We wanted to show a lot of people, but we didn't. They're not individual characters that are generated in the world. As you can see, we have different sizes, male, female. We have different races. We have a variety of different types of clothing. We talked about the 7 different regions, and we have, you know, different people in different regions have different types of clothing. No one's really brought it up yet on the internet, which I'm shocked by, is the one trailer where the shark comes right out at the camera. There's just a, like a grown man swimming in whitey tighties. And I'm just like, that's really saying a lot about like the economical kind of situation in that area where it's like, I can't afford a bathing suit, but I really need to, I need this freedom.
As opposed to, let's say, scuba gear.
Yes, like a fully decked out scuba diver. So that way too, it kind of helps. We wanted there to be multiple levels in the world, so it's not just like people above water, and then there's like fish at this level. So we, you know, we have deep ocean, we have, you know, certain fish that will swim here, certain fish that will swim there, and then we wanted to bring some people in the world, and we'll have recreational divers, but then these are actually, this is the model for our hunter diver. So there will actually be divers that will be hunting you under the water as well, and they can obviously be a bit of a nuisance, but also a nice treat to snack on. And then so you go from things that obviously don't look like much of a threat to you. You know, it's kind of like this nice part of the menu. It's like, it's not a huge risk to go for the Atlantic spade. And you only get, you know, this much sustenance from something that big. But you can go a little more high risk where you could eat other sharks. We have alligators. I mean, even the various types of sailfish and marlins with their nose can be a bit of a threat, but obviously something like a hammerhead shark can be even that much more dangerous. So that leads us into, you guys earlier saw this character hiding in the pipes around all the bodies and whatnot, and you saw the scale of this massive apex predator in the world. So like I was saying, you go from kind of like low risk into like medium into high, and these are extremely high. I was actually looking at a chart like just before we left that was like supposed to show the difficulty level. And yeah, there's certain levels as like the pup shark trying to fight this. You're just asking for like the most difficult situation possible. Because as you guys could see, this gator was absolutely massive. This was a really fun one for the team to work on. So I actually recently went to Gulf Shores, Alabama, and I don't know if it was a poor parenting mistake, but I took my little kids to a alligator farm. So it was slightly fun, but also primarily terrifying. And they give your kids a bucket of food and you go, and so we learned a lot about these alligators, and it was nice because we were kind of in production of these assets and were able to apply some of the knowledge that we learned at the alligator farm back here at work. So for example, this character you can see is missing one of her arms. We did a lot of research very early on in the project, and we would watch various YouTube videos and documentaries and whatnot. And we saw this horrible video of like, it was at an alligator farm and they're like chucking chickens in and feeding them. And just this like giant angry alligator rolled over to grab one and essentially grab the arm of one of the other gators. And they do this like death roll where they bite and spin. And it just took the other gator's arm off. Wasn't gory, wasn't violent, just took it off. And you could see the other gator just look at him like, Steve, you need to chill. There's plenty for all of us. You don't need to be so aggressive. But when we went to the alligator farm, we actually learned a good bit about how, I didn't know if someone started throwing frisbees already. We were kind of unsure on like the validity of removing stuff, but we actually found out that alligator's blood coagulates much faster than most things out there. So it was very common for lost limbs, tails, eyes, stuff like that. And we really wanted to make sure our apex characters stood out as characters and not just like, we have alligators in the game as well, but we didn't want it to just be like a larger alligator. And obviously you do see that Rosie here in some of the previous shots had a big pink bow on her. She was a very, I think there's some like environmental storytelling you'll see in some of the billboards where it shows her when she was like a young show alligator. And obviously I think she's become a bit jaded in her job and is now taking it out on everyone. So this is just one of our apex predators, and you've seen it from concept to the high poly model to here you see the final in-game asset. And she is pretty aggressive. Some of the other apex predators that you will encounter is our very, very sick barracuda, who is swimming in an area that has suffered a little bit of an accident, I would say. There's some slight radiation issues, so it has caused some odd growths, enlarged red eyeballs, and a pretty serious problem with authority and just general aggression. We wanted to take this time, too, with these apex predators to kind of pay homage and respect to some very classic things that most people would want to encounter in a boss battle. So this was kind of our love letter to Moby Dick here, and this was actually a pretty fun character to develop with design, animation, and character art department. You can loosely see in some of the images that there's all these various harpoons and ropes tying it down that obviously many hunters and whatnot have tried to capture this character over time and apparently have not done a successful job of it. One thing, as in the general pipeline at work, we try this idea of plussing. So it's basically when you're given an asset, your job is to never change it as, and this is what I think would be cool, but it's like what is best for this character and for the game. So one thing that our character artist Andrew did a great job of plussing in the game was, in the sketch, I just did this really loose drawing of like an anchor being pulled behind it. And we just thought that would be another cool element of storytelling of that, you know, this massive sperm whale has obviously wrecked ships and boats over time and whatnot. But Andrew took that idea and did what was best for the character. And I think he now has like 4 or 5 anchors tied around its tail. So you saw what our shark could do with a tail whip to a sea turtle. Imagine what a massive sperm whale with anchors tied into and embedded into its tail, tail whipping you, would do to you. It's not good, basically. So now moving on to the idea of growth in the game. These were some of the first things that we did at Tripwire when we started Maneater, and it was starting to think about the player shark. We've never officially like really come up with a name for the shark. We just refer to it as the player shark, so maybe you as the player can kind of come up with your own little backstory of what the name is. But just like the apex predators, we wanted there to be some sense of character to it and not just you're a bull shark or you're this fish. We wanted you to have some sort of identity. And we didn't need this like massive back lore of you are Sir Didymus of such and such of the year. We wanted it to be recognizable and iconic. So when doing this concept, we were almost thinking more of graphic elements. And when we first did this first pass, it just wasn't enough. Our art director, Sean, brought up some really good points of wanting to affect the silhouette, because so much of what you see of the shark in the game is either from the back view or when you knife. That's what's basically called when the shark is at the surface and you see that knifing of the fin come out, which they actually don't do a ton of, but it looks pretty cool, so we kind of bent those rules for the game. So here we're starting to think about affecting the silhouette a little bit, you know, like since you're seeing the player from kind of more of an over-the-shoulder view a little bit, do we remove parts of the back tail? Do we kind of cut areas down the side? Then we kind of ran into the situation of it being like too scarred, where like, are you going to feel like you are still an imposing threat upon other things in the world, or are you just going to feel like weak and tired the whole time? So we really wanted to make sure that you had a scar that told a story, but you didn't feel weak. So we did, the concept on the bottom is essentially what we came up with. We won't go into a ton of details of how you got these scars, but there is a pretty jarring incident in the game that causes this. And then obviously, there was a good bit of like when we would have meetings of like people crawling on the ground and kind of like interacting like, well, then this happens and it cuts you here and then this happens. So that's a pretty accurate description of, I think, of what would happen. And you can see in the pup in a moment how it ended up looking in game. So obviously you see the scar affects your silhouette, it affects your gills, your eyes, you can see the terror that you have been inflicted as a young newborn pup. We're definitely saying pup a lot, just because when you research baby shark these days and someone with two small children, it gets stuck in your head a lot. And there's been lots of, are you guys doing the baby? We got it. We've heard that one.
At least one person who is very high up on the food chain at Tripwire likes to play it occasionally.
Yeah, it's like a form of torture, I would believe. So yeah, the pup here, as you can see, that scar is there. You have this look of then moving into the big guy here. So that's what you grow into, something a little bit more imposing, something a little bit more impressive, something that at one point was terrified of the horrors of this big world, is you are now the thing that is inflicting horror upon those who have done you wrong. We're not going to tell you a ton about, so this is the adult. We have five essential growth stages from the pup, the teen, the adult, and then
there's potentially ways for your shark to grow beyond what nature has intended.
Yeah, so you get pretty gigantic. While doing some of the research, one of the things that we found out about, without giving too many details of what you could become, there's been some research in different parts of the world when they have captured, or basically kind of caught, it was about 16-foot to 20-foot great white sharks, but were eaten in half. Like, they were, like, literally, you can look up these images, and it's, like, this, like, 17-foot great white shark that has two bites out of it that look like what you would take out of a sardine. So there's basically ideas of massive sharks that we might not even have seen yet. So, yeah, our player shark definitely has a story to tell. We took some artistic license with a bull shark. We wanted you to feel unique. We are not trying for a scientifically accurate bull shark. There are parts that we liked from great whites. There are parts that we liked from Makos. There are parts that we liked from tiger sharks, a variety of different stuff. The thing that we noticed really sold the bull shark aspect were the eyes. Bull sharks have a very cat-like eye. And we just thought that that was something a little bit more unique. And at one point, we just had a more subtle black eye, but when we added this, we felt like it really kind of sold that iconic element of a bull shark. So the next thing after you grow in the game, there is also the ability to see evolutions, which we've talked about before, but you are the first people to see any of this. So hopefully this isn't jarring, because right now I'm just trying to gauge the room of, like, what the hell have they done to sharks? We really wanted to sell the fantasy of becoming not only an apex predator in the world, but becoming this ultimate sea monster, essentially. So you have not only all the speed and power, but you have things that you would have never imagined you have before. So this was one of the early ideas for what essentially we were calling, and are still calling, the, your bone evolution set. With that concept, we then do a block out in 3D just to see how things start to look. We have multiple ideas for different types of evolutions that you have. Now, the thing that, just to kind of get a little technical with you and for some of the game dev folks that might be watching or here in the audience, even though it's just a shark and it looks pretty straightforward to build, we have five various stages. You grow throughout the game. You have scars on you. And then we have the ability to have these evolutions. And then on top of that, what we wanted to do with the evolutions is that you can have different parts, because they're not only visual, but they also affect your gameplay as well. You know, like we were talking about, you can stay on water a little bit longer, and there will be some other things that we'll leave for you guys to discover when you're playing the game. But we wanted the ability to swap out pieces. So maybe you have a piece that allows you to do this, and instead of wearing the whole bone set, maybe you would want the head from one of the other sets. So we noticed with that last 3D pass that some of those elements weren't going to really work with that system of being able to swap things. And it wasn't super clear and as iconic as we wanted it to be. So we kind of simplified things, stepped back, and we broke the character up into multiple regions, almost like it's armor for your shark, but we didn't want it to look like just tacked on, like, it's a robot guy with the laser, and we wanted you to feel like, we looked at a lot of prehistoric creatures and tried to use that to influence what this would look like. So as far as creature design goes, we wanted it to feel believable, but also kind of like, I don't want to say otherworldly, but just something that we haven't seen in this lifetime, but maybe there were sharks that looked like this at one point. Our character artist Andrew did a fantastic job of blocking this out in 3D, as you can see. Nice, big, iconic shapes. It really changes the presentation of the player shark, but yet you still know who you are. You still have elements of that scar coming through. So all of these pieces are broken down into multiple regions that, like I said, if you wanted to take one of the other evolution headsets, whether it's based on the aesthetic look of it or the kind of traits that that piece gives you, you can swap that head out with this tail and that body and those fins. So yeah, we were really excited to kind of sell the idea of what you could become. So I hope you guys enjoyed that vision of the evolutions. We have multiple more of them to show, probably as we get closer to release, and hopefully you'll discover some on your own as well. Thanks so much, guys. I really appreciate you checking out all of the hard work that all of the departments at Tripwire have been doing.
Yeah. I guess we have some time for some questions, if people have them. I'm not sure if there are mic set up, but we're happy to
I think there's through. A mic set up right there if anyone wants to ask a mic or just holler out, whatever you guys are comfortable with.
Yeah.
All right, so you guys already mentioned baby shark. How about left shark?
I mean, if you watch...
You want, like, full legs? More like a weird centaur, like half shark, half man body? You, sir, have a job. I don't have any power for that, so I really spoke out of turn. I apologize.
That was the best answer to give. We're keeping the game fairly grounded. Yes, there are fantastical things about it. You saw through the Bone Shark Evolution set. But like Brian said, the goal there is to try and think about monsters that could exist.
Yeah.
Like, sharks don't have bones, but what if they did?
Yeah, one thing I like to think about with doing character and creature design, and particularly creature design, like when I teach, I always give the example of the alien facehugger being one of the best creature designs to ever exist. It's clearly otherworldly, yet there's so many elements that are super recognizable. We see hands, we see something spider-like. Then on that aspect, there's a form following function where, like, when you flip it over and you see what it is and what it's going to do to you, there's no question of, like, should I pet that? Very clearly, like, I don't want that on my face. So we try to keep that kind of in mind a little bit.
Yes, every single one of our locales is based on a fictionalized region along the Gulf Coast, from wonderful sandy beaches full of tasty, tasty meat bags and fancy bathing suits, to less socially, economically advanced areas where there are people swimming around in underwear, and quite a few things in between. You saw in the video we played Fontic Bayou in Crawfish Bay, and you saw how we had crystal clear waters in Juan, beautiful seals, and the same will go for what you see on the shore as well, and the buildings there, and perhaps the city that it represents, to areas that are obviously, okay, there's a couple shacks here, and little boats with fans on the back, and quite a few other areas, including a golf course.
I have to apologize to, like, the one person watching out there who does swim, like, in underwear. Is, like, fully offended by this. Like, sir, I am making a statement.
Maybe.
Well, we represented you in the game, so. Yeah.
Are there any plans to implement any sort of multiplayer aspect of the game, or is it primarily just a single player?
For Maneater, it's going to be a single player experience. We really wanted to tell a story, and this is one of Tripwire's first games where we're able to do this, and we really wanted to focus in on that. Now, we do have some high hopes for what Maneater will do, and if it reaches those hopes, we have plans to keep going and perhaps add to the franchise over time.
Do you have any plans for DLC that you have too far ahead so far? For the, maybe another protagonist type of shark or additional content?
Plans, official plans, I'll say no. Ideas, yes. Right now, the team is focusing in on finishing out the game and getting that done. But teams are going to start pulling off being content complete for the game's completion. And at that point, those plans are going to start coming into fruition, and they're going to start looking at what we can do next, from new regions, new types of bosses, both in and out of the water, and things like that are all ideas that we've had. And we're sure that our players will let us know what they want to see as well. I think just about everybody we met at Gamescom said, are we going to fight Cthulhu in the deep ocean? And I'm like, no, but now let me make a note.
I would be fine if we did. I hope if you guys really want to see Cthulhu, help as the community kind of, we need that.
Yeah. Not very far. You're going to pretty much get a little bit on the beach, and that's about it. You're not, you know, getting in a car and driving into the big city. I know the term GTA with sharks has been tossed around. It's not that literal.
Yeah, there's not like an escort mission where you have to then like go on land and like pick up your cousin or whatever and drive him somewhere.
Yeah. He wants to go bowling.
Yeah. Your gills are only so big.
There are areas where you will be able to sneak around, perhaps through sewers, perhaps through the use of advanced breaching techniques, and being to hop from little pond to pond, let's say on a golf course. And
Level design and environment have done some stuff. Like as the character department, right now everyone's so focused, everyone's kind of working together, but in their lanes and focusing on their tasks. And I have to say, there's quite a few times recently that like I've been playing the game, and like I did not think I could go over here, or like that's a really interesting way of getting here. And a lot of the hidden stuff, like you saw with the bodies floating underwater, there's definitely a good bit to explore.
What type of like progression exists? Like, are you just able to explore and like you avoid what you can't kill and you kill what you can, or do you like get new abilities?
Combat is inevitable. You are a shark. You eat meat. What you choose to eat, to a large degree, is up to you and how you choose to do it. Through the game, at the very beginning, you will clearly see there's a story that is taking you along a path. You will be able to break out of that path if you want to and go straight into the deep ocean as a pup and have a very interesting life experience. We aren't going to stop you if that is what you want to do. But there is a story driving you forward, and it's going to encounter a series of events, potentially battles, up into a great finale where the story will end.
In your E3 trailer, you used the song of Mississippi Queen, which is awesome. But did you maybe reach out to all of those to get
an We reach out to quite a few musical groups about licensing certain songs whenever we think about any game. And it really comes down to finding the right partner. We generally have a couple ideas that we think will work. And it comes down to the reasonability of the song and just the artistic direction that the team decides to go with eventually.
Yeah, like what's really going to kind of fit the overall tone of the game.
Yep. So I don't want to say we absolutely reached out for Hall & Oates, but I would be surprised if we didn't. I would say for most, the land to sea probably wasn't the biggest thing, and even like the comedic but serious and bloody tone, you'll see some overtones of Killing Floor's, you know, pedigree in that. But there are definitely challenges, and Brian, I'm sure, can talk more about.
Yeah, I mean, I think art content had their challenges, but a lot of it is still pretty much the straightforward process of what you would do for any game. With switching from a lot of human-based anatomy to animal anatomy, and then they're being pretty different animals in the game, from large fish to small fish to seals and whatnot. Like, we didn't notice till very late that sharks had ears. I don't know if, like, it's one of those things that when someone says it to you, you're like, of course sharks have ears, but, like, really, do you know that? And so we were, like, the character team was, like, frantically Googling shark ears, and we're like, is what we have acceptable? Like, is this going to be, you know? Or we didn't realize till a little bit later in the game, just like Jurassic Park, there are no male sharks in the world of Maneater. Male sharks have claspers. Females do not. And we would use, like, to help save time, we'll kind of use, like, a base shark, and then we can very easily kind of, in a program called ZBrush, it's like a digital sculpting program, we can kind of, like, shape and morph and re-sculpt it into something else. So that's a weird little, we weren't going to use the word fun fact.
Yeah.
It's not a fun fact, it's just a fact.
But I would say probably the greatest challenge for us, because as you mentioned, we come from a game, well, we come from multiple games that are multiplayer, co-op, or versus centric. And for us, this was really doubling down on let's tell a story. Let's do that. No comment. Somebody down here?
How did this concept come into existence?
So for those of you who are Killing Floor fans, you may have heard us talk about, or may have even met at some point, Alex Quick, the original creator of the Killing Floor mod. After partnering with Alex to acquire Killing Floor and ship it, Alex went off and made his own game called Depth, which was divers versus sharks. And after he completed Depth, he said, I want to do more with sharks. And he started working on the concept that became Maneater. He came to us and we said, that's amazing. Nobody's thought of that before. What's the last open world shark game that you've played, or a shark PG? And nobody had an answer. So we're like, yeah, let's do that.
Yeah, because last year when we announced it at E3, we were just publishing it. And it got such an incredible reception after our E3 trailer. We just had to take it in-house and put like all of the Maneater Tripwire on it.
Yeah, I thought I was a pretty big shark fanatic as well. Like in some of the other interviews, they've mentioned that we have an artist at work, which they were referring to me, where like my wedding cake was, like the groom's cake was Bruce the shark from Jaws. I'm pretty into it. I've made my poor wife watch that movie more than is possible. And so like John Gibson, our president, was really excited for me to meet Alex. And I just thought, like, I had a real Mako shark mouth, like, on my desk at work, just as random decorations as most people do, I'm sure, at your offices. When I met Alex, I was just like, I'm going to drop all this shark knowledge on him, but he definitely knows way more about sharks than I do. So it's been fun during the early parts of developing the player shark. His team had a version of the player shark very early on, and it's changed over time, but the base that they gave us was essential for us getting to where we're at today as far as the player shark goes, for sure.
That's for you to discover.
Wow. That was aggressive.
A lot of iteration, and iteration. We definitely think we're coming in on some really great controls. We've played just about every aquatic-based game there is to get an idea of what's worked, what hasn't worked. If you haven't gone back and played some of the extremely old ones, it depends on how much you fondly remember those games. Some of them do not really hold up that well. And we think we've nailed something, because we want our shark to feel good in water, out of water, transitioning from exploration to combat, and want it to be seamlessly with all the controls, pretty much doing the same thing, but just with different environments. And we think we're really honing in on that, and we think people are going to be super, super happy.
Yeah, animation and design have focused on that a lot. And I think one of the big things that they do, I really enjoy our animation department, is they're incredibly collaborative and are just, you know, like, try this, how's this feel? Because especially with a shark, very early on, there was a lot of like, should he be able to do this? Should she be able to do this? Should she not be able to do that? And in the end, it's just like, what feels fun?
Should she be able to tail whip things out of her mouth while jumping in the air? Obviously, the answer is yes.
Yeah.
Or like the floppy fish physics, like when you jump up on a boat and just kind of like shimmy across and eat people. Like, that was just kind of
there's been some discovery.
We're like, well, that actually looks pretty cool.
And it looks pretty scary too on some of the, like, the larger hunter boats, where there'll be these pretty massive boats with guys on the back throwing all sorts of projectiles and stuff at you, and you like jump on the front and eat this guy up front, and then just like shimmy your way back. And just the look of terror in this poor guy in the back who's just like throwing explosives at you, like his last ditch effort.
Yeah, I think like this demo we showed you is, it's probably 4 or 5 months old. It was pre-E3. You could probably see in the footage we showed afterwards, a lot of the movement and animation was a lot more refined. And going back and playing this, you know, like for Gamescom and for PAX, and then playing like the newer builds, it just feels that much more like smooth and fluid.
And that's going to be something that continues to be tweaked and refined on until essentially content lock comes around and we're told we can't touch it anymore.
Oh, sharks totally do that, man.
Yeah, our shark can totally strafe.
There's a lot of monster energy drink for sharks that
sharks
just kind of
very much
them.
Do barrel rolls. That's how it's the fastest way to get across the ocean, I'm told. Yeah.
I think that falls under the situation of what feels fun, what feels effective, and like what do you have in your tool chest essentially to not only navigate in the waters but also fight.
Yeah, Jared touched on it earlier with the combat. You know, in newer builds, you can like grab anything that's like thrown at you, like explosive barrels, and jump up and whip shot those back at boats and explode them. Or, you know, like swordfish, you'll shoot those back and that acts sort of like a sniper rifle, like impaling.
I hit a seal with a turtle the other day and felt kind of bad about it.
I'm going to get yelled at for this because I keep bringing it up internally and everybody keeps telling me no. Turtles should skip across the surface.
Oh, wow, that's... Yeah.
Like, kind of like a bear of monsters.
What's... Yeah.
The turtles are my favorite food to play with.
As you can see, every time, well, him going through the demo as well as the video where he may have been the driver, every time he comes across a turtle.
You got a tail whip it. You got to.
We're based out of Atlanta, and I kind of live out in the country, and I have this, like, little creek that goes in my backyard, and I guess it's like just the season, if there is one. And I've had all these turtles come in my backyard when I'm doing yard work, and I'll pick it up and show my kids, and I'll take photos.
And then
I feel awful because I'm taking these photos, and I'm just like, I wonder what it looks like if a shark bit you in half.
Yeah.
It's a dark moment. We can edit that part out.
Note.
This is only being streamed, I guess. Other questions?
You could have the turtle being thrown like a frisbee.
Ah, that's right.
Yes.
We should have, next year we'll do a half-eaten turtle frisbee for you. Because you guys are clearly have something against turtles here.
And obviously our marketing department really didn't think of that one.
I'm making turtle frisbees now.
All right, I think I've got one more question in the back there. There are definitely much bigger boats in the game.
We have very small ones
which are pretty fun to just instantly obliterate. Yes. As I touched on while we were playing the demo itself, the mass of the shark plays a super important role there. If the mass of the shark is bigger than that little love boat, the paddle boat that you decide to ram into, you're going to obliterate it and chomp down on the thing inside.
Worst date ever on that
On something
boat.
Like, let's say a Coast Guard cutter, hunter boat or something, maybe you're jumping on the deck and ripping open a door to get that pilot out of the room or something like that. And then for other things, they're just perhaps even too big for the most monstrous of sharks.
What the platforms?
We've announced for PC on the Epic Games Store, and that is all we can say right now.
Yeah, we hope to have an official street date announcement very, very soon.
With that, I think we've got two wonderful Astro headsets to give away. I think one for a shark question and maybe one for, let's see. Let's do two for shark questions. As our chief sharkologist on the board here today, Brian.
Shark questions. Okay. Trying to think of a few good ones here for you. Should we do it based on some information that I've already given them as a little bit of a hint?
I'd say one easy one, one hard
one. Okay. One easy one is, with a show of hands maybe, or we can see, is what would make anatomically, and not the most obvious one, a male shark, what is the difference between a male and female shark? Saw that hand go up pretty fast. The claspers. There we go, sir. Congratulations.
Astro headset.
There you go. You want to handle the hard one? You got any ideas for the hard ones?
You're the sharkologist.
Oh, man, the sharkologist. Poor Alex Quick is, like, just shaking his head right now. Just like, man, you got to be kidding. All right, this is going to go really deep dive on you. This is going to be my nerd level here. The six-gill shark. What fin is it missing compared to most other sharks? The six-gill. Oh, man, this guy was like, there was such confidence at first. And
I want to see the
animals. Whoa, these guys are throwing. Oh, wait, we got. That's correct. Yeah. Actually, and I forget that it's a documentary on Netflix. It's pretty good right now. Check it out. But yeah, it's very streamlined up top. You're very welcome. And also just check out the six gill in general. That's something I would like to see in the future in Maneater. That's something I'm very excited about. They're like these super deep dwelling sharks that are super ancient and terrifying looking.
And with that, we're being told the panel's about to be over. So thank you.